high throughput sequencing that you need to map. For RNA sequencing, we first have to see how RNA transcription is done. We have a gene, it has a beginning. This part is not transcribed. It's kind of some signal to say, okay, transcription starts here, and it'll be exon, intron, exon, intron. After the initial transcription, to make the RNA from this, this is the primary RNA, the introns are being spliced out, and so the useful part are being stitched together. Okay, and then this will go out from the nucleus to the cytoplasm and to be translated into a protein. And so we want to know how the RNA are transcribed. Ideally, we want to know the protein, but right now the proteomics approach are not as accurate as the RNA approaches. So the RNA-seq, in terms of the actual protocol, is you first get the
can you go back one slide?
Yes. Okay. So the original thing is you isolate some cell or tumor, you know, whatever. You get the RNA, you isolate the RNA, and you remove the DNA within it. There might be some contaminations from the DNA. Sometimes you also want to remove the ribosomal RNA because these are too abundant, way too abundant. And then after that, you can fragment. Yeah, so the ribosomal RNA, not only they're abundant, they don't really change too much between cells. You don't really want care so much about our RNA expression. So you want to remove them. And then you get the, you add magnesium to the fragments in order to make them shorter. It's just more concentration that the RNA will break into small fragments. And then at this point, I'll show you later, we can make a cDNA, which is from the RNA as a template, to make a DNA double-stranded fragment out of this. And with that, we can add sequencing adapters to the end, and then amplify in solution a little bit, because sometimes, depending on how big your sample, you know, the cells you have might just be, say, 100,000 cells. You may not have enough DNA to really go into the sequencing, so you amplify it a little bit. And then select a range of sizes. Usually, when you go sequencing, the actual sequence going in, you read out, depending on the machines you use. I think the fragments in the middle are usually like 300-ish size, plus the sequencing adapter, so which add another some bases on the outside. So you select the fragment range, and then you put them onto the sequencing. For sequencing, we mentioned last time, some student asked me this question. Remember, on this big flow cell, you in situ created these DNA clusters, right? They all have the same sequence, but remember there are two adapters. They are actually different. You know, there's A adapter and B adapter. Sometimes B is on the top, and sometimes A is on the top. And within this region, you can choose to just sequence one. And for example, if I only add the so when you do sequencing, you know, basically sometimes it's A end on the top and sometimes it's B end on the top. If you add something that aligns to the A end, it will start sequencing, you know, down. But after you finish this reaction, you can wash it off and then add the A alignment adapter, and then you will sequence the other end. And so they will give you a read that's kind of going in both directions. Okay? You can choose to do it either single end or paired end. If you do it in paired end, it will cost, you can see, twice as much time and twice as much reagent. And also because the reaction overall, you know, gets tired, usually the second read is not as good quality as the first read. So they, depending on the sequencing company, how much money they ask you for, you could choose to just sequence one end. Although right now, a lot of machines, they just default sequence paired end, regardless of whether you need it. And you are given the second read for free, which you always want, okay? In terms of going from the RNA to this cDNA step, there are two ways you can do this. One is called oligo-DT because all the mRNAs have a poly A in the end. And if you do this, actually the RNA is automatically eliminated. This will give you So in this case, you generate the mRNA first, and then, but this approach sometimes will give you a bias towards the 3' of the transcript. But if you fragment the, or you can choose to align with random primers, which will be more even. So sometimes people will do this selected by poly-T, but first, and then still use random aligners to get more even amplification across the transcript. Okay? The advantage of RNA-seq with microarrays is you do not need to know the genome sequence or the predicted genes or predicted transcript. You just know I'm isolating the RNA, whatever it is, I'm going to see, and then decide what they are. You do not need to design microarray probes ahead of time. It's a digital representation. Every time you see a read, it is definitely some molecule that came from your original thing. So when high-throughput sequencing came out, the sequencing facility was really excited. Because previously with microarrays, it's kind of an analog signal. This region has high or low signal, but sequencing is just, yes, this is one read. Everything is a count, right? It's a kind of more straightforward. It has higher detection range. If you look at affymetrix array probe signals, there is a plateau towards the end. When the transcript gets too abundant, the microarray, well, in that spot, it will saturate the probe. With sequencing, the more you have some molecule, you will sequence more of that gene or that transcript. You can detect the new genes, things that you didn't know was a gene. If you sequence it all, now you know this region has some transcript coming out. You can use it to look at alternative splicing. So this is going back to here. For some transcripts, it might be all the exons are used, you know, A, B, C, D, E, but then some genes, depending on the different tissues, organs, or whatever drug treatment, they might select a subset of these exons to be stitched together, you know, A, C, D, E, or A, B, E, something like that. So these are alternatives, the splicing events. In the early days, array companies also tried to use probes targeting, you know, like there is an array from affymetrix called exon array. So anything in the genome that remotely look like an exon, affymetrix would put four probes in here, and they were trying to look at the probe signal to figure out the alternate splicing, but it's just really, really hard. So now with sequencing, you can actually look at this much, much better. There are other more advanced functions, such as mutations. You can imagine if this is a cancer, like tumor sample. If the gene has a mutation, that gene, when it transcribes into an RNA, will also have a mutation. And you can see that sometimes from the transcript. And also gene fusions. We will talk about gene fusion is basically this region, this is one gene and another gene. They are sometimes in totally different chromosomes, but somehow in cancer they get stitched together and they are transcribed. And in some RNA-seq reads, you can see a read going from the first gene to the second gene. So these are very, very useful approaches, ways that it's a lot harder to detect with microarray. So in terms of experimental design, so there is a rival poly-A, so this what we mean is using the poly-T as a way to enrich for the poly-A transcript. And so this way you get the you get like really the mature transcript, okay? These poly-A is only added after splicing, and you can enrich for exons. There is also another way called the ribo minus. You just get out the ribosome. And so sometimes the introns are still in there, and also some of the non-coding RNAs may or may not have poly-A tail. They will also be enriched in here. And so you just remove the really housekeeping ribosomal RNA. The rest, all the genes pre-spliced, everything is there. There are also protocols for strand-specific. So in the final transcription, you know which strand, because once you convert into cDNA, sometimes you don't know which one was the original strand. So there are different kits you can buy to get these strand-specific RNAs. Sometimes for link RNA, especially if you don't know this gene, like, oh, is it going this way or that way, right? So you can use strand-specific methods. And for sequencing, so when high-throughput sequencing came around, initially people sequenced like 5 million reads on some sample. Later on, it gets cheaper and cheaper, 10 million reads, 20 million reads, you know, 30, 50. And also companies now can do this. You just send them RNA, they process it, like they prepare the sequencing library or core facilities, and then they sequence for you, right? And so I remember sometimes you collaborate, say your lab is, oh, you know, actually it's true, like last week, a lab member told me, oh, there's this company. You send them RNA, they can process and they can sequence for $200 a sample. I'm like, wow, that's so, you know, so great. Because right now at our core facility, just preparing that samples from RNA to a sequencing library costs $275. If they can do, you know, library preparation plus sequencing at $200, but that one I'm definitely going to send them to do library preparation and sequencing. But at the same time, you have to ask, what does $300 mean in the actual sequencing reaction? Because most doctors just feel like, not doctor, but like a lot of people will just say, oh, a sample sequencing for whatever amount, right? They think they will get RNA-seq results, which will be great. The reality is, you have to ask them, for example, is it single end or paired end? As we mentioned, paired end sequencing takes twice as much reagent and twice as long time. You also get maybe 1.7-point amount of more data, right? Because the other end is not as good. So a paired end is getting more popular, but you can imagine for the same amount, I want a paired end because that just gives me more free reads, right? Sequencing depth is a huge thing. So right now, I forgot to mention something here. Sometimes when people add the adapter here, they directly add the sequencing adapter that eventually will go to the sequencing, the A and B adapters in here. Also, in the outside of the A and B adapter, sometimes they add a little, or inside, they add a little index. So you can put multiple samples on the same sequencing lane. Because Illumina, as we mentioned, in the early days, each lane gives you 3 million reads. Then it's 5 million and 10. Now each Illumina lane can give you easily 300 to 400 million fragments. And so you don't need to sequence a single sample, like just one sample on there. You can put multiple samples there. And so you can imagine at the end of the adapter is the A and B that you need to use for all of the reads. But a little bit inside, you could put in a few bases there, six nucleotides. That will tell me this is my sample one, sample two, sample three, sample four, right? So this is kind of an index on the adapter. That later on you can, every read coming in, you say, oh, this is this sample, that's this, based on those six nucleotides. Okay, so you can pull multiple samples together. So once you can pull, the question is, when they say they can sequence the sample for $200 a piece, are they putting three samples per lane or 20 samples per lane? Because the more samples they put in LA, yeah, they can squeeze the price, but you're getting less reads from the same sample, right? So I would say for differential expression, well, if you only need to know very low level gene expression level, maybe 10, 20 million reads is sufficient. If you want to know more accurate differential expression, you want to sequence deeper, especially if, say, you're dealing with a new mushroom genome, or you care about alternative splicing, the deeper sequence. You know, I think for alternative splicing, ideally you want to sequence like a hundred of million reads. Okay? So the deeper, the better. Of course, it will just also cost you more money. Next is read length. Early day, the first generation of Illumina sequencing gives 25 nucleotide long reads. Later on, it's 35, 50, 75, 100, now 150. And the length also is proportion. You know, but the longer you read, the more reagent they have to put in, the longer this thing needs to stay in the machine, you know, more cycles to get each additional read. The sequence quality will drop out a little bit. So the quality of data you get is not really proportional, but roughly proportional. Okay, so they also don't charge you proportionally more if you sequence longer. So the current, you know, like HiSeq 10 standard is 150, and you can get paired and 400 million fragments per lane, which depending on where you do it, it costs like $1,300 to $1,500. And you can easily put 4 to 6 samples there. Okay, so these are pretty useful measures. So next time when people tell you, oh, I'm doing RNA-seq, you need to ask for this information. So in the very early day of sequencing, also experimentalists were so excited, like, oh, we are getting digital readouts, right? It's, every read is there. There's no bias at all. Therefore, we do not need replicates. It turns out you still do, because you know there is like human-to-human difference, mouse-to-mouse difference, and those is not going away with just sequencing versus microarrays. However, the technical noise from the sequencing is considered to be less, and so usually if you have a cell line, you know, petri dish, that's usually better. You grow the petri dish 1 week, you grow the petri dish another week. They are considered okay. So 2 replicates is kind of the minimum for RNA-seq. 3 replicates is kind of the minimum for microarrays. Okay, so for RNA-seq, if you just want to get some like a very, very basic idea, maybe 1 replicate is okay. But if you want to ever publish, you should always do 2 replicates. If you are dealing with like really mouse, human, you know, sometimes even 3 is not enough. You might want to need 10, you know, if some drug treatment or whatever. Okay. Batch effects definitely still exist. As I mentioned, you prepare a sample 1 week now, and another week you prepare another batch. There's definitely still technical artifact. So try to be consistent and process all the samples at the same time. So better technology never eliminates the need for good experimental design. I briefly mentioned this in the microarray batch effect lecture. I forgot there. I have the slides later on. This is a PNAS paper published in 2014. The striking finding is, so they do the mouse as a human, there are different tissues, and mouse different tissues. You can see the humans are circles, and the mouse are all cones. After they get the RNA expression data, they cluster using principal component analysis, and you can see all the human samples are here, all the mouse samples are here. So this is saying that a human brain is closer to a human heart than a mouse brain, which is really hard to imagine. And a year later, there's another scientist, they say, we reanalyzed the data from this, and we found the following. The first batch is all human tissues. And so you can see, you know, this is a lane of sequencing, but they probably also process in a different way. This one might be okay, but look at this. This whole lane is mouse, this whole lane is mouse, these are all human, right? So, second batch human, the fifth batch, okay, there's some mixture. But if they know this ahead of time and use batch effect removal, actually now the samples do cluster by tissues, not by animals or by organism. You can still use COMBAT, not at the read level, at the transcript abundance level, to correct for batch effect if you can see something like this. It's still amenable. I would say COMBAT was designed for microarray experiment, and for RNA-seq, it works to some degree. It's not perfect. I know the developer of COMBAT, he's continuing to think about better ways to do batch effect removal for RNA-seq. So just continue to watch the field for better normalization. Okay? Questions for RNA-seq experimental design?